Molly Whuppie. Once upon a time, there was an old woodcutter who had many children. Work as he might, he could hardly feed them all. One day, he gave the three youngest a slice of bread and treacle each and sent them into the forest to gather wood. They went deep into the trees, and when they turned to go home, they had forgotten the way. They ate the bread and treacle and walked until they were worn out and utterly lost. Then, just as it was getting dark, they spied a small and beaming light chinkling out from a window. So the youngest of them, who was called Molly Whuppie and was by far the cleverest, went and knocked. A woman came to the door and asked them what they wanted. Molly Whuppie said, "Something to eat."
"Eat?" said the woman. "Eat? Why, my husband's a giant, and sooner say knife he'd eat you."
But they were tired and famished, and Molly begged the woman to let them in. So at last the woman sat them at the table and gave them some bread and milk. Hardly had they taken a sup of it when there came a thumping at the door. No mistaking that. It was the giant come home.
"Ah-ha!" he said. "What have we here? Three poor, cold, hungry, lost little lasses," said his wife. "You get to your supper, my man, and leave them to me."
The giant said nothing, sat down and ate up his supper. But between bites he looked at the children. Now the giant had three daughters of his own, and the giant's wife put all six of them into the same bed, for so she thought she would keep the strangers safe. But before he went to bed, the giant, as if in play, hung three chains of gold round his daughters' necks and three of golden straw round Molly's and her sister's. Soon the other five were fast asleep in the great bed, but Molly lay awake listening. At last, she rose up softly and changed over one by one the necklaces of gold and straw. So now it was Molly and her sisters who wore the chains of gold, and the giant's three daughters chains of straw. In the middle of the night, the giant came tiptoeing into the room, and groping with finger and thumb, he plucked up out of bed the three children with the straw necklaces, carried them downstairs, and bolted them up in his great cellar. Molly thought it high time she and her sisters were out of that house. So she woke them, and they slipped down the stairs together and out into the forest, and never stopped running till morning. At daybreak, lo and behold, they came to another house. It stood beside a pool of water full of wild swans and stone statues and a thousand windows. And it was the house of the king. So Molly went in and told her story to the king. The king listened, and when it was finished, said, "Well, Molly, that's one thing done, and done well. But I could tell another thing, and that would be better." The king knew the giant of old, and he told Molly that if she would go back and steal the giant's sword that hung beside his bed, he would give her eldest sister his eldest son for a husband. Molly smiled and said she would try. So that very evening she muffled herself up and made her way back through the forest to the house of the giant. First she listened at the window and heard the giant eating his supper. So she crept into the house and hid herself under his bed. In the middle of the night, Molly climbed softly up onto the great bed and unhooked the giant's sword that was dangling from its nail in the wall. Lucky it was for Molly this was not the giant's fighting sword, but only a little sword. It was heavy enough for all that. And when she came to the door, It rattled in its scabbard and woke up the giant. Then Molly ran, and the giant ran, and they both ran, and at last they came to the bridge of the One Hare, and Molly ran over, but not the giant, for over he could not. Instead, he shook his fist at her across the chasm in between and shouted,
"Woe betide ye, Molly Whuppie, if ye e'er come back again!"
But Molly only laughed and said, "Maybe twice I'll come and see ye, if so be I come to Spain." Then Molly carried off the sword to the king, and her eldest sister married the king's eldest son. "Well," said the king, when the wedding was over, "that was a better thing done, Molly, and done well. But I know another, and that's better still. Steal the purse that lies under the giant's pillow, and I'll marry your second sister to my second son." Molly laughed and said she would try. So she muffled herself up and stole off through the forest to the giant's house, and there he was, guzzling as usual at supper. This time she hid herself in his linen cupboard. A stuffy place that was. About the middle of the night, she crept out, took a deep breath, and pushed her fingers just a little bit between his two pillows. The giant stopped snoring and sighed, but soon began to snore again. Then Molly slid her fingers in a little bit further. At this, the giant called out in his sleep, and his wife said,
"Lie easy, man. It's those bones you had for supper."
Then Molly pushed in her fingers a little bit further, and they felt the purse. But as she drew out the purse, a gold piece dropped out of it and clanked onto the floor. And at the sound of it, the giant woke. Then Molly ran, and the giant ran, and they both ran. And they both ran and ran until they came to the bridge of the One Hare. And Molly got over, but the giant stayed, for get over he could not. Then he cried out across the chasm,
"Woe betide ye, Molly Whuppie, if ye e'er come back again!"
But Molly only laughed and called back, "Once again I'll come to see ye, if so be I come to Spain." So she took the purse to the king, and her second sister married his second son. There were great rejoicings. "Well, well," said the king to Molly when the feasting was over, "that was yet a better thing done, and done for good. But I know a better yet, and that's the best of all. Steal the giant's ring for me, and you shall have my youngest son for yourself." Molly laughed and looked at the king's youngest son, frowned, then laughed again, and said she would try. This time, when she had crept into the giant's house, she hid beside the chimney. At dead of night, when the giant was snoring, she stepped out and crept towards the bed. By good chance, the giant lay on his back, with his arm hanging down out over the bedside. And it was the arm that had the hand at the end of it, on which was the thumb that bore the ring. First, Molly wetted the giant's thumb. Then she tugged softly and softly at the ring. Little by little, it slid down. But just as Molly slipped it off, the giant woke with a roar, clutched at her, gripped her, and lifted her clean up over his head.
"Ha-ha-ha-ha-ha! Molly Whuppie," says he, "once too many is never again. Aye, and if I'd done the ill to you as the ill you have done to me, what would I be getting for my pains?"
"Why," says Molly, "I'd bundle you up in a sack, and I'd put the cat and dog inside with you, and a needle and thread and a great pair of scissors. and I'd hang you up on the wall, be off to the wood, cut the thickest stick I could get, come home, take you down, and beat you to a jelly. That's what I'd do.
Ha 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 ha! And that, Molly, says the giant, chuckling to himself, that's just what I'll be doing with you.
So he rose and fetched a sack, put Molly into the sack, and the cat and dog besides, and a needle and thread, and a stout pair of scissors, and hung her up on the wall. Then away he went into the forest to cut a club. When he was well gone, Molly, stroking the dog with one hand and the cat with the other, sang out in a high, clear, happy voice, "Oh, if only everybody could see what I see!"
"See, Molly?" said the giant's wife. "What do you see?"
But Molly only said, "Oh, if only everybody could see what I see! Oh!" At last the giant's wife begged Molly to let her see what Molly saw.
Then Molly took the scissors and cut a hole in the corner of the sack, jumped out, helped the giant's wife up into it, and as fast as she could, sewed up the hole with needle and thread. It was pitch black in the sack, so the giant's wife saw nothing, and she soon asked to be let out again. Molly never answered her, but hid behind the door. Home at last came the giant, with a wood club in his hand, and he began to thump the sack with the club. His wife cried, "Stop, man! Stop! It's me, man! Oh, oh, man, it's me, man!" But the dog barked, and the cat squalled, and he did not hear her voice. Then Molly crept softly out from behind the door. But the giant saw her. He gave a roar. And Molly ran, and the giant ran, and they both ran, and they ran, and they ran, and they ran, till they came to the bridge of the One Hare, and Molly skipped over it, but the giant stayed, for he could not, and he cried out after her in a dreadful voice,
"Woe betide ye, Molly Whuppie, if ever ye come back again!"
But Molly waved her hand at the giant and flung back her head. "Oh, never again I'll come to see ye, though so be I come to Spain."
Then Molly ran off with the ring in her pocket, and she was married to the king's youngest son. And there was a feast that was a finer feast than all the feasts that had ever been in the king's house before. And there were lights in all the windows. Lights so bright that all the dark long the wild swans swept circling in space under the stars. But though there were guests by the hundred from all parts of the country, the giant never so much as gnawed a bone.